24. 2100 hours, December 24th, 1944, Nuremberg, estate of the governor.
Peter, go to the cellar and get some more of the plum cake. The children are eating it faster than we can cut it.
Captain Fisher Rowe spoke over the noises of the children in the phonograph.
Yes, Captain, I had no idea they would eat so much.
Peter was flushed and excited, thoroughly enjoying his role as host of their adopted orphan children in the estate mansion.
Do you think we should bring their gifts to them now?
Let them enjoy their treats first.
It was Werner's idea to bring the children from the deaf school and a second orphanage to the governor's estate for Christmas Eve. He would play Father Christmas and bring the children their gifts. In the few months since he intervened to save the child Marie from being run over by the truck, he had embarked on a journey that had literally given him new life. He had first grown attached to her from a distance. Peter had noticed and had commented to a few of his closest friends that the captain had grown noticeably softer in tone and generally more agreeable, had seemingly regained his joie de vivre. Werner, for his part, had grown increasingly detached from the demands of Information Minister and, except for times when he could go to the park and watch the children play, had tired of the task of spreading lies to the populace. He had invited Peter to start walking with him on his morning route, and they regularly sat at the bench in the park to watch the children at play. Marie was their favorite, and the two men had even tried to communicate with her, which they found frustrating, but discovered that pushing her on the swings and organizing games with the children was more satisfying. The supervisors were more than happy to have the assistance of the two men. Marie had begun to teach them sign, which they found difficult at first. She laughed unbeguiled at their attempts to reproduce representations and letters. Slowly, they had acquired a level of skill to communicate with her, and as they grew more competent, they were stunned at her level of intelligence and knowledge. One day, as they watched their new protege disappear down the street with a group of orphan children, Peter was surprised to see the office of the Reich strangely quiet. Werner said to Peter quietly, "I wonder what it would like to be the guardian of this child." It was the only time Peter ever heard him say it. In time, her dark hair grew out again, but no teacher or orderly made any attempt to explain or cover it. And as for the question of her heritage, the two military men of the Third Reich did not ask. As the end of December approached, Fisher Rowe suggested a holiday party for the orphan children of Nuremberg. Its value as a public relations move for the officer of information made it a reality. Now, as he looked over the event, Peter marveled as he watched the captain transform into Father Christmas, handing out gifts to the orphans one by one and showing a patience and kindness he had never known existed in the officer. The children sang at midnight for the many society people who came to sponsor and assist at the event. Peter watched the captain brush away tears as they sang, "Stille Nacht, Heilige Nacht." Marie was on the captain's knee, and she signed the words as the other children sang. Their trip home with Peter and the chauffeur Duesenberg was quiet. Indeed, it was a somber Stille Nacht for the declining Third Reich. It was only a few days before Peter came running up the stairs outside their apartment on Lohengrin Street and burst into the captain's study.
"They have taken her, Herr Captain, Marie and about 20 others from the orphan school."
Werner jumped up from his chair.
"I knew there was something wrong. She was missing today. She and some of the other children. The dark-haired ones, I'm afraid." "Just as you fear, I have heard there is a citywide sweep to reduce the numbers of orphan children. Naturally, the headmaster told us, the infirm and those who have no papers confirming their Christian descent are the targets."
"What did they do with her?" Fisher Rowe was barely maintaining civility.
"I did some investigating. To the Nuremberg Penitentiary," Peter told him. "They will be held there briefly, then shipped off to the trains."
"My God," he sat. "She is on her way to Treblinka, to the ovens." They were frozen for a moment, Peter in his coat and Captain Fisher Rowe in his smart uniform. With steely resolve, the captain responded,
"Call a car, Peter. We are going to the penitentiary."
1100 hours, January 6, 1945. Nuremberg Penitentiary for Prisoners of the State.
In 30 minutes they found themselves standing in front of the office of the warden of the penitentiary. The captain had arranged the meeting quickly through his position as officer of information. He told Peter, "We will come on the pretense of talking with some of the political prisoners of the state to entice them to write papers in praise of the Reich, you know, in change for certain privileges." Peter nodded in admiration. "You have a reputation for this. It should not arouse suspicion." Fisher Rowe replied, "Yes, but in the last few months, the process has become less appealing. Look around, Peter. The domestic resistance to the Führer has grown along in proportion to German losses, and the result of my interrogations of late is a growing list of martyrs." They knocked on the door and were told to enter. The warden greeted them standing, behind his desk, facing away from his guests, his arms behind his back. Warden Gasser was a little man who wore his uniform and his political position with equal pride. He was a career man, shrewd, who had a reputation for wielding his power potently and sometimes mercilessly. The warden was intrigued by the thought of certain advantages he could gain by having influential friends from within the Office of Information. Indeed, he could barely contain himself, relishing the game about to begin, especially knowing he had the upper hand for bargaining by being in his home territory. He decided he would begin by putting on his toughest mask, then perhaps show some leniency to gain the advantage. He turned to his guests. He was not smiling. "How can I help you, Herr Captain?" he asked, without offering them a seat. Fisher Rowe observed that three of the warden's men were sitting in the only three available chairs. He knew the opening gambit. It was meant to diminish bargaining status and leverage. Fisher Rowe was not impressed. He began, "Warden, we have come here for two reasons. First, to speak to some of the political prisoners about writing public letters to their constituents praising the Führer and the Reich, in exchange for certain privileges which you will be happy to place in force once they have completed their tasks to the satisfaction of my office and the sovereign offices of the Third Reich." Peter marveled at the authority and the calm demeanor of this man beside him, who continued to surprise him almost every day since Marie had appeared in his life. "In addition," the captain continued, "it has come to our attention that some of the Jew and Mischling school children being held in your facility have committed acts of sabotage to the local police officers in our city. These very children may be planning an attack from within your facility. I have come to interrogate them and to release a number of them back into the public at large. I suspect they may lead us to members of the underground." Warden Gasser returned. "Ah, very good plans, Herr Captain." He nodded his head cautiously and took a few paces around the room. "And for what compensation would I be willing to release detainees from my prison or to bribe prisoners?" Fisher Rowe ignored him. "In addition, we shall need privacy for all our negotiations." He paused, waited. "Do I need to make a call to your Gestapo supervisor, Warden Gasser? I would remind you he is a man of short time, short of temper, and under extreme pressure these days, as is all of the Third Reich." Warden Gasser sat back down at his desk, his bluff called. However, he was not yet ready to give up, and he needed to save face in the presence of three of his officers. He spoke to the three. "It appears we need to have a discussion involving state secrets, so the three of you may leave." He nodded to his attendants, and they abandoned their seats and left. After the door had been shut, the two men sat in the available chairs without invitation. The warden offered schnapps, but they declined. Fisher Rowe took out his watch and gave it a ceremonial stare. Warden Gasser was fuming. He had been beaten at his own game, outmaneuvered and outgunned. Finally, he spoke. "Well, I suppose that, due to the unusual nature of the detainees being children, you may have privacy for your proposed interviews. And, of course, you may meet with any of our political detainees. Just give me a list, and I will see to it that they are released into your custody for a private meeting." "Yes, at our discretion and time." Grudgingly. "Yes." He stood, eager to salvage some advantage from the meeting. "I certainly hope to be hearing soon from the Information Minister." The captain waved him off and returned to the business at hand. It might be a good idea to release several of the moderate adult detainees as a gesture to the domestic resistance, he suggested. Peter glanced sideways at the captain, but he quickly saw this was merely a diplomatic move. The warden turned his palms up, apologetic.
I am sorry, Herr Captain. We cannot release any of the adult detainees. The Gestapo has arrested them, and there is nothing I can do. But tomorrow at 1100, you may see the children in A16, the meeting room. They are going to be entertained by one of the prisoners.
Then it is agreed, Fisher Rowe said as he rose. Tomorrow we will go to cell block A16 with your guard. He will stand outside, and we will ask for his escort again at 1200 hours. Afterwards, we will speak to some of your political detainees. This could be a very profitable exercise for both of us, Warden. Goodbye.
The warden snapped back a heil, and the two men left the room. Outside the door, Peter breathed a sigh of relief, and Werner merely raised his eyebrows. The first part of the plan was in place. Tomorrow they would appear at the prison to conduct their interviews privately.